The two armies, Hittites and Assyrian, meet. The Hittites lose the battle, and the Assyrians carried off thousands of Hittite prisoners and brought them back to Assyria. If you take people out of their own land and bring them to yours, they will be exiled and scattered, and they will likely lose their sense of being part of a nation. After this battle, the king of the Hittites, Tadhalia, he retreats back to his capital city, Hattusas, and his army begins to dwindle. Let's introduce the king of the Assyrians. Students, be careful that you don't get Tadhalia IV and Tukulti-Ninurta confused. They are different people at war with each other, and they're in different locations over different kingdoms, so they are distinct people, but they have similar names. So try not to get them confused. So Tadhalia IV is the king of the Hittites, while Tukulti-Ninurta is our new character, the king of Assyria. Tukulti-Ninurta didn't continue to invade the Hittites after Tadhalia fled, because Tukulti, our Assyrian king, had to go back to Assyria to deal with a problem that had risen up while he was off invading the Hittites. This problem was Babylon. If we remember, the kingdom of Babylon is located roughly southish of Assyria, and the Babylonians and the Assyrians always had sort of a strange relationship. Assyria and Babylon had both at different times claimed the right to rule over the other. They both believed they owned the other kingdom, but neither kingdom could actually claim power because they were about equal in strength. Oh, by the way, this would be a good part to start looking out for the answer to question two. So they're about equal in strength, Babylon and Assyria. They also have similar cultures. This is because both Babylon and Assyria had been a part of the empire of Hammurabi. You remember him? The Babylonian king who established that great Babylonian empire and wrote down a law code, one of the earliest law codes in history. So both Assyria and Babylon had been a part of Hammurabi's great empire. And as a result, both of them were stamped with the Babylonian culture. Hammurabi's code at this time in history existed in the city of Babylon as a stele, which is a word we learned a long time ago, that is basically a sort of rock pillar that sticks out of the ground that has engravings on it. So Hammurabi's law code was on a stele in Babylon. That will become pertinent later. But for our purposes right now, know that Assur and Babylon have the same culture. They also have this in common, that they use the same form of writing. The Assyrians use the Babylonian cuneiform. And the last, perhaps the most significant thing that these two cultures had in common is that they worshipped the same gods. They did call these gods by different names, but they acknowledged that their gods had the same stories. As a result, whenever the Assyrians and the Babylonians were at war with each other, they had an understanding of respect for the religious places. Assyrians wouldn't plunder Babylonian temples because they worshiped the same gods, and same goes for the Babylonians. They would show respect for the Assyrian gods by respecting their places of worship. So those are all important things that the Babylonians and the Assyrians have in common. Tukulti-Ninurta, our Assyrian king, while he was off fighting the Hittites, the Babylonians tried to take some land that lay between Babylon and Assyria. This was land that had been disputed between the two kingdoms for some time. So while Tukulti-Ninurta is off fighting the Hittites, the Babylonian king takes the opportunity to take the land. This is like you and your sibling fighting over the rights to an electronic device, and when that sibling leaves, suddenly it's yours. And when he comes back, then you have to deal with it. Not that I've ever experienced that before. Well, Tukulti-Ninurta, much like your sibling who comes back and finds you on the envied device, was not happy to come back and find that Babylon had taken over this piece of land. He responded, as we all do, with warfare. He took his armies and he advanced against Babylon. And he was actually successful. He invades Babylon and gets far enough that he's able to plunder the temples of Babylon. And as I mentioned before, this is unheard of. Assyrians don't plunder Babylonian temples because they worship the same gods. Well, not Tukulti-Ninurta. He goes in, plunders the Babylonian temples, and he even takes the images of the gods away to Assyria. Specifically, the image of the god Marduk, M-A-R-D-U-K. This was a risky move for Tukulti Ninurta to do, because by stealing the image of Marduk, he risked offending Marduk. And we'll come back to that idea. After defeating the Babylonians in battle, Tukulti Ninurta of Assyria proclaims himself as King of Babylon and Assyria, and thereby merges the two kingdoms together. But that won't last for long, don't worry. Tukulti Ninurta of Assyria, again, takes the Babylonian king prisoner and brings him back to the city of Assur in humiliation. He leaves Babylon behind under the authority of an Assyrian governor. So his thought is that he will rule Babylon from a distance. Well, with Babylon now included in Assyria, this means that Tukulti Ninurta at this time is the greatest king in the region. Tukulti Ninurta celebrates his victory over Babylon by building new temples. This is kind of a thing with great kings, evidently, is to build a lot of stuff. He builds new temples and he fortifies the city walls of Assur. He also constructs a royal mini city for himself just a little north of Assur. All this aside, there was still unrest among his people. Babylon, who he recently conquered, is understandably shocked that Tukulti Ninurta would invade and plunder the temples of the gods. And so were some of Tukulti Ninurta's own Assyrian people. They were afraid that Tukulti Ninurta had offended the gods by what he had done, and they weren't pleased with him. So in spite of Tukulti Ninurta's best defense of his actions, the Assyrians actually conspired against him. Eventually, his own son and the nobles of Assyria revolted and cast Tukulti Ninurta from the throne and killed him with the sword. He had reigned for a rather lengthy 37 years. He did. Tukulti Ninurta's son took the throne and attempted to fix his father's wrongs. He sent the image of the god Marduk back to Babylon, to his original temple, but the Babylonians were still angry, and almost as soon as this kid is king, they rebel against Assyria. Well, remember the governor that Tukulti Ninurta had left to rule over Babylon? Yeah, he gets scared and he has to run away from Babylon. So Babylon now declares itself free of Assyrian control. And that is the end of the blending of those two kingdoms. But it was a nice try. Good thought. Elam. You've probably forgotten them by now, but there is another people group that dwells in the east, and we have mentioned them before, but not in great detail. These are the Elamites from Elam, and they have been looming. They are still present. And when they saw that Assyria was weakening, they pushed the eastern borders of Assyria. They pushed the borders back all the way to Nippur, and they invade Babylon. Poor Babylon, it's getting rough. So they invade the city of Babylon and have enough force to actually march through the streets of Babylon and plunder the temple and take the statue of the god Marduk. Again, poor guy. First he's captured by the Assyrians, and now he's captured by the Elamites.
Why are you so obsessed with me?
The Elamites also took the steel with Hammurabi's law code on it and brought it back to their city. This was never recovered by the Babylonians. It lived in Elam until it was uncovered by archaeologists in the 1900s. Oh, and they also took the Babylonian king captive. So now Babylon is in a real tough spot. Their god statue has been taken, the steel of Hammurabi with the law code has been taken, and also their king. And that is a great blow to Babylonian pride. We'll come back to them briefly. But the Assyrian king at this time, remember the son of Tukulti Ninurta, he is helpless in all of this, and he only actually ends up reigning for 3 years before he is replaced by his own nephew, who only reigns for 6 years, who in turn is replaced by an uncle who reigned only for 5 years before being removed by a usurper. You do not have to remember all of those. All you need to know is that the Assyrian kings were a bit of a wreck after Tukulti Ninurta. There's a high turnover rate of kings in a short amount of time. Babylon, again, is not much better. After their one king was trucked off to Elam, a new family took over the Babylonian throne, because evidently the Elamites came just to plunder, not to settle down. The new king of Babylon began what is called the Second Dynasty of Isis. This dynasty didn't do so hot either, as the first four kings rose and fell in the space of 15 years, which is a very short amount of time to raise and lose four kings. We're going to leave Assyria and the Babylonians, but know that they have been at war with each other and with other nations. Babylon is especially struggling. Both nations are having difficulty finding a secure ruler. We will come back to them eventually, but we're going to leave them in their distress and talk about the Hittites real briefly, and then we will move to Egypt. The Hittites. Remember Tadhalia IV? Well, he died actually of old age, which is a rare blessing for any kings of any kingdom at this time, it seems. But after his death, his sons and cousins fought over the throne of what little was left of the Hittite Empire, and that led to more unrest. We are leaving the Hittites, the Assyrians, and the Babylonians all in states of turmoil.